common friend, so that you can see. These are nice people when they come on here. So, anyone who is not aware of the term technical debt? So you will learn, eventually, it's a debt that you will incur in the, through technology or through software, mostly through code. And this was coined along with the agile, the earlier agile days, and then but the definition of it has been more very differently than what was visualized. So this talk is about what is technical debt and how do you approach it, and how can you avoid those kind of situations, or is it a good thing or a bad thing to have a debt? So that's all about it. So when we talk about technical debt, the normal terminology or the visualization that comes to is messy code or unreadable code, or it's really reckless. Okay, I don't know what it is doing, I don't understand what is happening. Shortcuts taken, not the way the things have to be done. Instead of that, things are done in a different manner. Improper design, wrong use of patterns, or wrong kinds of data structures used at wrong places. Those wrong kind of fact, wrong kind of tools used for wrong things. All this can result in technical debt. And code without test, that is, when you change something, you need to know whether it's working or not. The ideal way to do that is through automated testing. So if you don't know whether the change code is working or not, then it results in technical debt, because we don't know from where the bugs can come from. So these are the normal things that comes to everyone when we talk about technical debt. And let's look at some examples. So just bear with me, I don't think there are any lot of Ruby people over here, but most of my code is Ruby, but Ruby is very readable, so I don't think you will have a problem in understanding. And technical debt is easy to understand, if that you can just see it and say, okay, this is a problem. So, most of the code that I've taken are real examples, either that I have seen or I've seen it in the internet. Most of them are real examples. So this is a big, everyone knows about MVC architecture. This is a code that we have seen in one of the controllers. You can see a lot of if statements, nested ifs, and lot of places query being called within this. When we have MVC, ideally lot of things that could have done in a model is being done on the controllers. And this is a Rails code. Rails is very supposed to be the most intelligent MVC framework, and you can see a lot of assignments taking the parameters and assigning it to that. Those kind of things need not have to be done in Rails, but it's being done. So this is a real messy code, real reckless code. If someone has to make a change into this, it will take a lot of time, even if it is just like one line of code. And this is what you usually see when you talk about technical debt. This is what it is being called as. And I'm sure almost all of you have seen different variations of this kind of code. Not exactly the same, but different variations of this. And another one is eating exceptions. So rescue is a classic example I've seen in many places. You catch an exception and you just don't do anything. It's a huge problem. Because exceptions are real exceptions. And if you don't know what is happening in the exceptional cases, then the software is dead. And another interesting thing on the same line is just logging into the debug. I don't know whether this is worse than the first one or this is better. But both doesn't add any value. Another interesting thing you can see is lot of these are classic examples of naming. Where you say section 1, what is section 1? I mean, why can't you call section 2 as section 1? What is the difference between section 1 and section 2? For a person who is looking at the code for the first time, how does he understand what is section 1? So naming is very, very important. If you don't name it, it might just confuse people. And it can create a lot of confusions, and it can create a lot of unnecessary bugs in the system because of wrong names. And so what happens with this kind of situation is that, say this code is like this, and you have to change something, you have two options, either clean up something and change it. But what usually happens is, the pressure will be to deliver faster. The easiest thing is to add one more line of buggy code into that, and that cycle continues. And it creates more stops, and then and always, as programmers, we always hear this complaint that we always deliver super late, and we don't want to deliver late. And then we try to do, okay, let me do one more shortcut. Okay, I'll do one more shortcut, but that results in more lates. And that's a vicious circle. It never ends. Okay, and that is where the beautiful terminology comes in, what we call as legacy code. Okay, and it doesn't happen in one day, right? It happens over a period of time. And this is one of the best definition of legacy code I've ever seen. So what is legacy? What is legacy is code written by someone else. So this is not by me. This I've taken from, have you heard of this tool called Code Climate? It's a tool which tells you the code complexity. It's a cloud tool which tells you the code complexity. And but it usually supports only independent languages. It doesn't support Java, and they have always been supporting independent languages. So the creator of that code, Brand, is the one who gave this definition. And any code that you've written 2 weeks back is legacy. You don't know why you've written. After, if you're not touched that, you go back, you don't understand why you've written. And this is the best definition. Legacy is not years, it's just 2 weeks. Okay. And so this is and the thing is that anything that we can't maintain, we just call it a technical end. That is what is coming to now. Okay, so let's step back a little bit and see what Wikipedia, where all definitions are given and it seems to be maintained by community and corrected by your time, has to say about technical debt. Okay, so technical debt is in it was coined by a person called Bart Cunningham, who created the tool Wiki, who is a creator of Wiki, and he created this term comparing it with monetary debt. Because the reason was, he was working on a financial project and he had to explain to the stakeholders what will happen when you take shortcuts in your code. And the best way to communicate to the financial people was to use the similar terminologies. That's the reason the word debt came there. Okay, and so it is like monetary debt, that is, everyone takes loans because you want a temporary, you have some requirement and then you have to fill in at that point of time. And it is good, it's not actually bad, because provided you pay it on time and you know that why you are taking it. Just taking loans just for the sake of it, have a problem. When you really need it, if you take it, it's a good thing. So it is like monetary debt. It is actually good. That is what it is saying. It is good because you get temporarily you get some advantage because of that. Provided you pay it on time and maintain that pay on time for a prolonged period of time, or when you think that okay, it's time to pay it off completely, pay it off. Okay. And this is what Cunningham explained. I'm not playing the video. I'll share the slides. You can watch this. He explained this is how when he started, why he used the technical debt, the terminology debt, was to communicate to the financial people because they were the stakeholders. And the best way to explain that was to use the similar terminology in that space. And that's the reason the word debt came in. But what he saw afterwards was people using it just for defining messy code, as his intention was not writing poor code is never a technical debt. Technical debt is taken because you wanted something quickly. At that point of time, by taking this shortcut, I know why I'm doing it. it's not an excuse for creating an architecture like this. Okay. And
I have a different thought. Can you go two slides? I think 3 slides back. So in corporate or even as all startup, so they start, they have a proof of concept. So the developer says it's working, that's a production. So once it is started working, right? You don't touch it.
Keeps on increasing.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, there is nothing like prototype and production code. Prototype is working, that's a production.
That happens. So it happens everywhere. There is no team which doesn't have technical debt. And this kind of situations, this is the same vicious circle I was talking about. Right? And it starts clean stage. Everything starts in a very clean stage. And over a period of time, it becomes messy. But how do you react to it? I mean, adding more debt doesn't mean any result. They mean that we have to come out of it one day. And the model, how can we do that? Okay, so understanding it is a mess, and I add more to it, and I need a solution, and this is the way to take it forward is one thing, rather than just going with that flow. So I'm trying to explain what we can do, and also this talk is mainly to differentiate, okay, any graphic code is not technical debt. Okay, the technical debt was defined with the purpose of getting short-term results. And don't combine that with any shortcuts people are taking. Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, we say code can be made to developer, but manager also comes into existence. They tell that you have to deliver today anyhow. So managers are also responsible for this.
Yeah, I'm not saying it is just developer's responsibility, but we'll come to that. I'll tell certain things which you can do, try to convince your manager. Okay, you can use Wolfgang's talk itself to convince your manager. Because there are a lot of things available in the internet to convince, okay, this is why it happened if you go to take this part. But the thing is that you need to react. Right? That most of us doesn't do. Okay, and this is just an attempt to react for all of us to the reality. Okay? Okay.
Maybe for the lack of better words, I'll use very simple words here. Let's say you are doing a prototype and write a bad code because it's a prototype. Once it is production ready, I'll write a good code. That's never happened.
No, that is where I differ.
So you can't, okay, this is a rough drawing, let me scribble it. Once it is production, I'll draw it with scale, sketch, pencils, etc. That doesn't work. Whether it's a production code, text code, etc. You can clean your home only with a good broomstick. You can't have a dirty broomstick and clean your house. And you can't blame the dirty broomstick. It's your attitude towards cleaning. So, what I've seen in my experience is like whether it's any piece of code, it's your architect. The architect should speak. I mean, people should ask who wrote this code. Instead of asking, who wrote this code, man? That's one key takeaway for this problem actually.
Yes, we So we don't accept this kind of architecture from any other streets, engineering streets. Even if it is a temporary bridge that we are building, we will not do it. I am comparing it with the proof of concept that you are saying. Okay, even if it is a temporary thing that we are saying, we are going to stay in this house for 6 months, we don't take this kind of crap in that house. We will not stay there. Right? And we don't stay in this kind of situation also. Right? We don't like that. But if we are saying that we can't accept it from others, why are we trying to contribute to that? Either silently or by not taking any action. That's a question that I'm trying to ask this to myself. Don't say that, don't think that, okay, I'm always doing the best thing and then I'm trying to preach for here. Okay, I also contribute to this or not. Right? Do we react to bad code? Do we try to take shortcuts, even if it is for a proof of concept? Or do we try to be competent and prudent at that point of time when we are writing a book, like any other profession? Okay. So the best definition of technical debt. So technical debt, summary I am trying to say is that it is not messy code. As prudent, competent programmers, we are not supposed to be writing code in a manner which others understand. Okay, because it will be the other person who will be reading the code, it will be us only. After 2 weeks, it becomes legacy and we are going to come back and read it, and then we will ask ourselves, who wrote this crappy code? And it was me who has written it, right 2 weeks back. Okay, so this is by Martin Fowler. He created a quadrant explaining, okay, what kind of technical debt exists. So his perspective is a little different. He says, whether it is a debt or not doesn't matter, the terminology doesn't matter, what kind of a bucket it comes to. And most of the discussions that we have comes from the first bucket, where it is reckless and inadvertent, where we don't use a proper layering mechanism, proper design patterns, proper naming, okay, or proper packaging of classes, or proper arrangement of classes or arrangement of methods. Okay, those comes under the first category. Okay, which we should be doing, which we are now doing right. Okay, and that is where most of the problem happened. I think this is the majority of the problem. And the second category is that, okay, I know that this is not the right way. I have certain pressures. I need to deliver certain thing. So I am taking a little bit of shortcut to deliver it faster, and I will take the responsibility of fixing it if I know that this is the way to take it forward. In this day and age where delivering faster and looking at where marketing, learning the market, okay, what works and what doesn't, right, that is more important than, we never know what the requirements are, okay, because it keeps on changing. So where it is more of like an experimental fashion, this might make sense. Okay, deliver it and see how users are using it. And if we know that, okay, this needs to be made, we'll fix it over a period of time. And the last category is, okay, we started using certain tools and then we used it in certain way. And after some time we realized, well, okay, this is not the right way to do it. Maybe there are certain things in the tool which I didn't know. This is how it should be done. It can be about languages, it can be about frameworks, it can be certain tools that we use. Okay, so technical debt ideally comes under the second two categories, not in the first, because those are prudent decisions, not reckless decisions. Okay, so, but the question is, how do you take care of the first category, first set of categories?
Still not clear about the definition on the left.
For example, what would you call as reckless versus inadvertent? So, reckless in the sense is like we improper naming or long classes or methods. Okay, those are fundamental things that we should be taking care of. Right? You don't need to learn to do that. Because we have been taught that, okay, shorter methods are good, shorter classes are good, proper design patterns of usage of proper design patterns at times are good, right? Those are the things that we expect from a competent profession. Okay, I don't care about all this. I don't care what kind of I don't care whether it is done in the professional manner or not. Those are reckless decisions. Okay, and inadvertent is, maybe you don't know certain things, but I don't care about it. I don't care whether this pattern has to be used over here. I just move forward with what I think is the right thing. Okay, so you learning on the go and improving your craft. Those kind of things comes up. If you're not doing that, then it becomes inadvertent and reckless. Okay, so usually that we see the legacy thing that we usually call, usually comes under that category. That's what I'm saying. I'm not saying the second one is not that, but mostly it will be the first one. So, how do we, on a daily basis, how do we do that? This is four rules of simple design, again from the agile world. That is, when you write code, it should pass all the tests and it should reveal the invention. Be it the variable that you are giving, be it the class that you are creating, be it the method that you are creating, it should reveal the invention. Okay, so the naming usually takes care of that. No replication. If you copy paste, do we copy paste? Then that's time for you to think. Okay, there's something better that you can do. The design patterns and all those kind of things comes under that category. Modularization, those kind of questions comes under duplication. If you have a lot of duplicated code, that comes unreal or a bit of time. And fewer elements. This is where the support complexity and other things comes into picture, and it is actually little contradictory to other things. So fewer elements is not about lesser classes or less methods. Write enough for what is the requirement for today. Don't think of tomorrow, I mean, or a prolonged period of time. And let the architecture evolve over a period of time. Okay, because sometimes what happens is that you may think that okay, this might be needed in the future, and you introduce certain architecture, which becomes that over a period of time. You don't need that. So do it enough so that what is the requirement for today and what you want to satisfy today, do it just simple enough for that. Don't over engineer. Okay?
I've always been a bit uncomfortable with this concept. And I'll tell you why.
Yeah, I've always been a bit uncomfortable and I don't fully agree with this concept because the definition of over-engineering depends on how much clarity you have on things. Let's say there's a problem which you know will occur 6 months or 12 months down the line, and let's say your current scope of work is 3 months, right? You're currently working on a project or a model for 3 months. But you know that 6 months or 12 months down the line, this will, some decisions you take now will cause issues. So what you're saying is factoring in those problems and designing for them or putting the foundation for them is over engineering?
If you know for sure, I think no. But then if you are guessing, if you are assuming.
Of course, if you're assuming that's a problem, but if you clarify then you know it's one of their problem.
If you know for sure that it's like a requirement
you already have. Right, it's not in the current scope of 3 months. And if you factor it in, 3 months becomes 4 months. But it will help you 6 months down the line or 12 months down the line.
Okay, but I just want to add to what you said. In the concept, what you said, like just in a code, and in the concept of emerging design.
Yeah.
Where you just write in a code, but you write it with all the pieces. Concept, solid principle, so that it's extensible.
Okay.
So that's what is emerging design, but a lot of people are not saying that you just have to write enough code, no matter how, and that will work. That will never work.
Yeah, I think that's the understanding.
That only you are just enough code. So if you are doing that, then whatever you are mentioning, then you will come up with 3 months or 4 months, most probably there will be a problem.
Okay.
But yeah.
So the assumption is that there is no design. That is not what I am talking about. There has to be enough design so that you can extend it. Okay, make it extensible. Okay, two key concepts which itself is another talk is emergent design and evolutionary architecture. Even architecture you can evolve. You don't have to think about 12 months in advance and do architect for that day. You can evolve over a period of time. So you need to have enough architecture, you need to have enough design so that it becomes more flexible in the future to add on. That's all I mean. Okay, so...
Just to add, you think the whole software is a big window card. Window card. So if you can take care of the screen and stuff, you can take care of the requirement analysis.
materials if you can make the buildings like solid blocks, solid block blocks. And within the materials you are worried about, you know, other five blocks in shape connected. So if you can abstract those blocks, you can get four. So if you want to make sure that you have four blocks, it is very thin. This concept, from the solid principle, you can go, you have very, very less dependency upon the but it is 400 maybe 6 months or 8 months maybe you get more than this. So you have to cover this place. If this blocks enough, I'm going to retract these blocks, or I'm going to add more blocks, but it's one part of the problem. Am I going to wire it differently or is the correct wiring? So if you're going to take 3 months, make sure that these blocks are in the consistent, then you are going to get this. That's what we are doing.
The point is, whenever you give software, you say it's good enough, so it's a good problem.
Yeah.
It's a good problem. It's a good problem. There is no shortcuts in the marginal software.
And next good, very good concept which is not being used effectively is, how many of you are familiar with this Boskov group? So, it's from the Scouts group. The Scouts, what they do is that when they leave that place, they make it better than when they came. Okay, so when you are touching a part of the code, make it better than what it was. Okay, look for improvement and do it. And then, refactor. It can be refactor. It can be renaming. Okay, or it can be better naming. I think that never stops. You always understand there is a better way to name things. You can continually doing that. And this is from Jeff Atwood. So he says there is no end to naming classes. You can keep on improving it. So this is also part of Boskov rule. Okay, keep it clean than what you entered. When you leave that place, better be than what when you have entered. And lastly, delete unnecessary code. It takes a little bit of courage to do that. And but I think this is we don't do it enough. Okay, because we don't know what is going to break. Most of the time that's the case. But you try to push yourself outside the comfort zone after the second or third time, you will get adjusted to that. Or create a safety net first so that you know what will happen when you delete it. Okay, but this is the biggest problem. Unnecessary code that we've written earlier, logic stays. No one knows and it will have a dependency, that library dependency is a hack. Okay, so don't do that. Be courageous to delete it. And this is where how do you convince your manager, those kind of thing comes from the courage also. Okay, so.
Okay. I want to add two points to that. The biggest way to write code is delete code.
Yeah.
That's the power. The second thing I will share from my audience.
Maybe can pass
it. Actually, we have a...
Let's say your phone is getting upgraded with the new software. Is it okay if your messages, contacts, everything goes away? You throw the phone, right? So similar feature. So for the feature to work, we can have database updates, etc. Right? In a complex product in our organization, we have a lot of code which is not delivered and nobody knows what it is doing. And the customer is now saying that I don't want the feature because I know that you guys can't make it work. It's coming under this umbrella. So it's a big statement, it's a shame on our organization, but that's the reality. It's because of this.
I think we are running out of time. Maybe another five minutes.
Okay, yeah.
Okay. Maybe I'll take the questions and then.
Any discussion you want to have with the panel during lunchtime?
Yeah, yeah. Maybe I'll accelerate the slides. We can catch up during lunch.
Yeah.
And so next thing is, how do you identify? Okay, so just to emphasize, technical code that is not messy code. We are writing good enough code which is readable, which we think, okay, there are people who will be reading our code after a few days. So keeping them in mind, we are writing code. But still technical that happens.
because something will be slowing down. But once, if you go back to Martin Fowler's quantum, there are some things that we learn over a period of time, because there are new users, new features, new kind of functionality coming to the system. Because of that, certain things will be slowing us down. Okay, so let's look at what is slowing us down. Most of the time, some places it will be the unreadable code, but that is, we know that, okay, through Moskow rule and continuous refactoring, we can fix it. There can be places where we don't have the automation, it can be test automation, it can be deployment automation, okay, or it can be like something that we need to set up for certain things to work. Because of manual work, it might be slowing down. Okay, there can be some wrong architecture that we have used. We thought certain things in certain way, maybe started off, but we designed certain tools to use, and over a period of time we realize that there is a wrong tool to use. And some complex dependencies which we started off, which is becoming a problem as of now. Okay, and I'll just skip this. In this, certain times, what might slow us down is when we work in silos, we work in branches. After a certain time, we are trying to integrate it, and that might be slowing us down. The merge conflicts, or say the regression issues, those kind of things also be slowing us down. So what is the solution to that? First, we start with continuous integration. Okay, and listen to continuous integration. If your commit bits are taking more than 5 minutes, or say more than 10 minutes, I would say, then there is some problem. There is something in the software that needs attention. Because continuous integration commitments especially is for you to tell you, okay, whether there is a problem or not. And if you have to wait for longer for that, then there is some problem. You have to see, okay, what is working now. It can be test taking a lot of time. If parallelization is the solution, it can be that. But it can be certain tools which might be taking a lot of time to set up. So look at that data. And look at your pipeline. I'm not talking about the actual pipeline tool, but how does a code travel from the commit to the production, and where it gets stuck. Okay? And most of the time it will be the deployment automation or test automation, manual testing, those kind of things what will be slowing us down. And look for those areas and improve. And the key thing over here is automation. And then comes to, okay, architecture. How do you fix those? Right? There are certain things that we have been using. We need to move away to something else because it's a wrong choice. How do you fix those kind of things? And there are two major technique that you can use. I'll just explain that. Maybe you are familiar with this. One is this technique called branch by abstraction. So you have to move from one kind of a way to implementation to another kind of a implementation. And then you need to clear up certain things that we have right now. So this is not refactoring, this is usually rewriting. You want to rewrite it either using new technology or you want to rewrite it in a better way. You realize that refactoring is not available. And in those kind of situations, what you can do is you can introduce an abstraction layer first, and then slowly migrate the implementation to the new one over a period of time, like this. And after some time, delete the old implementation. Okay, and this is a very good technique that you can use to continuously deliver, rather than, okay, go into silo, rely the entire thing, come back and try to integrate it. You don't have to do that, because that again is slowing us down. When you have to integrate again, the product would have moved further. So you can do this as part of delivery, normal delivery, and then you can go into the master branch itself. You don't have to maintain a different branch for this. And over a period of time, you can get rid of the old one. And this is usually at the other design level. Certain tools have to change. If you want to do that, it is one thing that you can use. Another one is standard pattern. This is most commonly used in the microservice architecture. You have to kill your existing application, rather than going into a silo and writing it for 6 to 8 months and come back and deploy it. You can, over a period of time, you can create smaller applications for certain parts of the system and then deploy it. It is immediate feedback. You don't need to wait for a longer period of time to get feedback on that.
And this is a very good technique. If you want to rewrite the render application using some other technology, or you want to segregate the multiple applications. Okay. So use this kind of techniques and continuously use refactoring and WordScout tool, then it will be maintainable or manageable debt. And which you know that, okay, there is no meaning who doesn't have debt. Every team has, because we are continuously learning from the market. We are continuously learning from the users. So it can never fail. Unless you don't have any users, then the architecture can be perfect. But what is the use of that product then? And just to summarize, just be prudent and confident. Don't try to be reckless knowingly. Unknowingly you might be creating, but that's fine. But knowingly that giving some wrong names, not creating smaller methods, creating a very longer methods, longer classes. If you don't accept it from, if you don't accept buggy architecture from your builder, then don't do this to our users also. Okay. And if you don't expect this to happen in other engineering streams, why is software engineering different? We have to be prudent. Okay. And optimize your flow. Always look at where things are getting stuck. Okay, in your delivery pipeline, why is it taking time to reach to the end users? And optimize for that. And remove the roadblocks for that. And that is your technical debt. Nothing else. And create a road like this, not a road like this in Bangalore. Okay, we can add up to this, right? Or you can try to go to me. You can be prudent even here. Right?
I see agility here and the other one is rules.
This is agility? Okay, we can have a different
conversation.
These are just references. Every professional should be reading all these three books. Especially the last book, which is a very small book called Growing Object-Oriented Design Guided by Touch. It's a small book. I've not seen many people recommend reading about it or recommending it. I will highly recommend that to maintain your tests as well as your production code in a very prudent manner. And these are some of the research I've done in this area. A lot of things are written. I'll share the slides so that you can look at this. And that's it. And my rants, similar to this, can be seen in this newsletter. So if you are interested in hearing more, you can subscribe to this.